Welcome to Celebrity Interviews with Paul. I have with me today Sir Neal Henderson, fellow Knight of Sufferlandria. Neal is a U.S. Olympic team coach for the cycling team 2012 and 2016 and would have been on 2020 if there had been one. He has also coached Rohan Dennis and Evelyn Stevens to the World Hour Cycling Record, which has got to be one of the most horrible events to complete. And in the Sufferfest world, he is known by the hashtag #EverybodyHatesSirNeal. So welcome, Sir Neal Henderson. Thank you.
Absolutely, Paul. Thanks for inviting me. It's really great to be here and chat with you and catch up.
Absolutely. Absolutely. Well, how is life in the pandemic for you?
All in all, you know, things are going well. It's been an interesting, I don't know, 8 months, I guess, or so, 8-9 months at this point. But all in all, you know, it's been some changes that have been actually, you know, in some ways positive. You know, for sure, there's a lot of, you know, minuses that are out there and things that didn't happen and we wish could have and would have and things that have happened that we, you know, have seen come to light that shouldn't have. But all in all, it's given me a little more time at home than I've had in the past 12 plus years. So there's a little bit of a silver lining there.
Absolutely. Absolutely. How are the athletes you're working with, especially I'm thinking the more elite athletes dealing with, with the uncertainties and the lack of events and all that?
Yeah, it's been a real challenge. And I'd say in the very beginning, things were just so dynamic. There was no known timing or structure where in many cases, you know, our elite athletes have lived on like a pretty rigid clock of things happening, you know, same events at the same time of year, consistently, no break in that rhythm ever. And 2020 being what should have been an Olympic year, again, there's a whole series of things in that way that are always, you know, very well defined and structured and laid out, you know, more than a year in advance. Last July, we were making our plans for July of 2020 in August, and all of those things kind of one by one just kind of boom, blew up, pushed out, became who knows, we don't even know. And so there is a lot of challenges with that, you know, going from what's been, you know, for most folks, extremely rigid and regimented to extremely unknown and variable. So right now the Giro d'Italia is going on. You know, this is absolutely crazy. Like the Giro is a May race, you know, it hadn't been a May race for, you know, decades, and now it's happening in October. And so everything has changed in that, you know, just using that as an example. The sport of triathlon, there's been so few races. They've had even, you know, I'd say more restrictions and fewer events than, say, professional cycling has had. And so, especially with triathlon, it's not something like you go out on a Saturday on your own and can really, like, do a triathlon. Cycling, you can, you know, at least go out, ride, you know, do a 100-mile ride, or you can do a specific thing and kind of, you know, pretty well mimic what a race situation is to a degree, to a larger degree than you can in a triathlon. So it's made things quite challenging, but everyone has been adapting because this is what we've got to deal with.
Got to figure it out. So this is my inside baseball Sufferfest. Kind of, I have two inside baseball Sufferfest questions. And one is, so I started writing these, the videos, when you downloaded the videos, and the first video I downloaded was Fight Club. And to this day, when I ride the original Fight Club, I usually am slightly nauseous at the end, and I find that my mental acuity has dropped until about lunchtime. Like, I get to even, I ride first thing in the morning, I get to work, and I'm like, I'm still like, wow, I am not really there yet. Have the videos gotten easier, Neal?
They have gotten more purposeful, I would say. there's I'd say some differences. So Fight Club and there's a few other classics that were developed before I started my involvement with the Sufferfest. And so they, some of those sessions are what we would border in the realm of almost impossible. You have to have all the stars aligned to be able to get through some of those original ones.
Right.
Generally speaking, now, you know, say Nine Hammers, that's one of my workouts. And clearly that one is also on the verge of impossible some days.
Oh yeah. That last interval's broken me more than once.
Yeah. But normally you're not in that, you know, you're not on that wavering level from early on and having to hold it all the way through. It really kind of, we get to that crescendo right at the end, the kind of that crux.
Right. Right. So yeah, I did 14 hammers earlier this week, and you know, it's a tough workout, but like after you get through the second 2 minute interval, you're like, oh, well, I can do the next three.
Yeah, and it's all downhill from here.
That last 30 second one is like, it's over already. This isn't bad. You know?
Yeah. And some of that structure is actually, you know, for here, you know, to both, you know, challenge, but also kind of give you that, like, that bright spot, you know, to look forward to, or really you get over a certain part and I can do this, you know, that's get true. That well, confidence.
Yeah. When I was running cross country in college, we used to say, get to them, get past them, get away from them. So it's like creating an opportunity for success. Whereas instead of just every time breaking you into little tiny pieces. So my other question is, since Sufferfest went from videos you download to an app, I assume at the end user agreements, I signed away pretty much all my rights. And one of my children, I'm sure, will belong to David at some point. I didn't read the details. So I assume you have all kinds of data. Have you learned anything? What have you learned from the data, that this massive amount of data from all the riders from all over the world?
Yeah, there's a couple things. Number one, you know, the classic way of training, you know, even when Sufferfest came out, was using one kind of point. One value, like a threshold value, FTP, that one point, and then assuming that everyone responds in the same way as a relative percentage of that, especially for high intensity work above that FTP, we realize that there is a really broad spread of abilities above that one kind of anchor point. And what we looked at and learned through some of the data, as well as some of the other athletes working with, were that there are these other ways that we can, you know, anchor, you know, energy delivery in a way.
Right.
And that the spread as we go above that FTP point gets bigger and bigger and bigger. And so having training be relative to one person's capacity is going to help the workout be more effective and more useful for that person. So that does come back a little bit to the, like, what's impossible, you know, for some folks, let's just say a couple minutes at 130% of FTP is quite possible. And they could actually repeat that a few times based on where their other kind of values, what we call like an anaerobic capacity or VO2 max are, or max aerobic power. Where someone else, they couldn't do a single effort like that because their kind of ceiling is at 120%. And so having those sessions tuned to your individual ability and physiology is something that the data has really shown through and guided us in being able to make those kind of adjustments and make workouts fit more people better. So it's kind of like, instead of ordering if I was ordering a suit, you know, I need I need, you know, not just like medium. I would want to have, if I wanted to fit right, I want to have the waist size for my pants and the length, at least. I want to have at least that kind of chest on the measurement for the jacket and the sleeve length. There's my four metrics that'll at least get it.
Right. Let's you custom tailor. Instead of just ordering a t-shirt, now you're ordering a custom tailor suit that adapts to each of the riders. So I'm 51. I've been using Sufferfest for about 10 years. My wife's 46, so some spin classes. I have three boys. I have a 20-year-old, a 16-year-old, and a 14-year-old that are all kind of athletic in varying degrees. If I took my family out to Boulder to the Apex Training Center and you ran us through your are you testing protocols and things like that, what kinds of things could you tell us about, like, our current status, and what kinds of things could you tell us about our potential and our future?
Yeah, there's a few elements. So in a way, when we do some of the testing in the lab, it's kind of a snapshot of where are you right now?
Right.
Within that, there's certain layers then that tell us a little bit about, you know, that upper end capacity and certain values. So, You know, if we think of a value like VO2 max, it's something that people talk about. And really what that is the ability to take oxygen from the environment into your body and generate energy in the muscles using that oxygen. So basically oxidizing carbohydrate specifically at that highest intensity. And so there's a whole chain of things involved with that, how strong your heart is, how many mitochondria you have within the muscles, the enzymes available there, et cetera. Training can impact that, but not at an unlimited event, an unlimited amount. So there's a little bit of a, like an aerobic ceiling that everyone has. If you want to go to the Olympics, my first recommendation is always choose your parents wisely.
Right.
They give you some of that genetic potential. So between you and your wife, seeing where the two of you were in those values, we would probably have a range, still a broad range, you know, 20 to 30% variation from that for any of your boys, could be both higher or lower than you. And so it's not always that people with super high have children that are even higher. It's actually more normal to have a regression to the mean if you have two really good high values, that it's actually more common that your offspring would actually be more average than even better. But occasionally you do get that amplification.
So could you tell my children how good they could be?
We could tell a bit about where they are strongest.
Okay.
In those different capacities, so their VO2 max. We also say sprinters are typically born, so you can't necessarily become a great sprinter. You can always improve your sprinting ability, but a real sprinter has, again, more fast twitch fibers. They have certain characteristics that we can modulate it a little bit, but we can't kind of change the stripes of a tiger kind of thing.
Yeah, I'll never be a sprinter. I learned that early and often. As a high school track runner and everything else, distance was going to be my world. That was pretty clear from the beginning.
And that's the one that we can see continued change over time. So the endurance capacity is often more related then to where your mental makeup is and where your focus is, your commitment, adaptability, all of those things that become more and more important as you go longer. So in a way, I'm actually more kind of sprint and power oriented. I did pole vault, javelin and discus in high school and swam, but you know, shorter distances. And I ended up competing as a professional triathlete for several years. And it wasn't because that was what my body's innate best abilities were. It's that I used the knowledge and trained over many years and a decade into it, I had that ability to compete at a high level.
Yep.
Not necessarily to win Kona, you know, Hawaii Ironman, but I was better than most, we'll say.
Right. So you look at people like Rohan Dennis and Evelyn Steven, and even said, you know, you want to go to the Olympics, you have to be born that way, right? To a certain degree. Your genetics is going to dictate a ceiling that you can only do so much about and probably very little. So there are different levels of people at the Olympics and different levels of people in the pro cycling peloton and at all those, particularly I think more the endurance kind of events and the running, the cycling, the swimming, those kinds of events. What do you see then as the difference between like the champion and like the almost champion?
Yeah, at that absolute highest level, it's, you know, the physical and physiological differences, I would say, from first to 10th are minimal. In some cases, negligible, or in some cases, even some of the lower place finishers had more innate ability. It then becomes what goes on here between the ears, how they manage anxiety, because it is normal to have a bit of an anxiety response when there's a television camera there, when you know there's, say, millions people, or even in some cases, you know, billion, you know, people watching you during an Olympic final 100 meter sprint, you know, Usain Bolt. And so there are individuals who are performers who enjoy that, who actually put out even more than they would in any other circumstance. There are other individuals that just don't manage that, those kind of pressures that come along with that in performance, and they perform better on a Wednesday night when nobody's there and they set a world record potentially.
Right.
But with all the other stuff that comes on, they don't manage it as well from how their psychological training preparation and really what they're able to get out of themselves in that situation. So there's a mental and performance aspect to that, which again is trainable. I know, you know, people again across the range that have gone from like okay athletes to then at the absolute best. And it was a switch sometimes in mentality, in building those skill sets and capacity to let it express what the ability was that they had. And so in many cases, then it's how they surround themselves with basically a team that helps them and focusing on the process, not an outcome. Those elements become more and more important the higher and higher up you get as an athlete.
So, hey, you got dogs too.
Yeah, we got three now. So
I got two. My small one's 90 pounds.
Oh, okay. Our biggest.
But I closed the front doors for all the barkers this morning. So, so is that something like, that sounds like something that not just elite athletes can pay attention to, right? But then, like, you know, people in their daily life can pay attention to, right? Yes. And whether you want to be the best salesperson in your fleet or you want to be whatever you want to be better at in life. Yes. That
definitely. Those skills carry over and they can be developed in all different ways. So athletics and performance in that is kind of one venue for that.
Right.
Being able to peel back layers, understanding what it takes to be successful, surrounding yourself with a team that are supportive in that way, having a focus on the process of what you're doing rather than what the end result is. You know, somebody in business, if they're focusing on like the end sales, but they're not thinking about what the process to do that, the relationships, building that up,
right,
that it's not going to work out. And so there is an element of that kind of continued process and trust in that process. You know, you're going to have waves up and down, right? Things are not always going to go according to plan. And when you're down, what do? If you panic and just give up, well, it's not going to work out. You have to kind of continue on and eventually you can turn things around. The other thing is when you're at the top, you don't just coast, right? You know, when you're in the lead of the race, it doesn't mean like it's done. It's not over till it's over. And you may be up, but you have to be prepared for an eventual change. And not being at that high point. And so managing both those highs and lows is a really big part of things too.
So, you know, I didn't think we'd get here, but I just published my fourth book, and this one's called Clear, Calm, and Connected, about church leadership and about coaching leaders in managing anxiety, being clear about their goals and their outcomes and remaining connected to one another. And it's interesting how much of what you have just said, you know, echoes those same kind of things. So it's all about human nature and how human beings manage anxiety, manage their surroundings, surround themselves with good people, whether it's intentionally trying to do something. And it's about process, right? It's about like working through the journey, not just like focusing on some kind of outcome.
Definitely. All of those things overlap so well. And it's not like I don't coach athletes. I coach people who do athletic events. Right. And I'm not coaching the sport or the event. It's coaching the person to be prepared for the thing that they're going to do, that event in that sport. And so a lot of times people put the focus in the wrong place. And so if you don't go to the person first and foremost, what their abilities are and where they have opportunity to be better, and where an opportunity is, you know, a weakness in some cases, we look at that. Okay, do we need to address that? And it may not improve the top end in some way, but we reduce, you know, that thing that may actually have a bigger impact if it's not addressed. And so those are the same things in all different respects and walks of life that we have to take into consideration and address from the human and personal perspective.
Absolutely. Well, Neal, where do you find joy these days?
There's a few things. I still enjoy getting out and riding. This year I've run a little more than I have in the past. I have some old injuries where running kind of was off the table for a few years. I haven't run more than I'd say I think I've run 3 miles consecutively once, a couple times this year. So literally a run for me is about like a mile and a half, 2 miles near home here. Early in the year, I kind of set a little goal of hiking up one of the mountains in Boulder, like just kind of at the edge from my home. It was a, you know, about a 4 hour hike to get to the top of Bear Peak. And, you know, those kind of things, you know, give me joy. And another big thing was garden, you know, something as simple as that. But in a way, there's a lot of carryover to what, you know, coaching and training is, you know, preparing. I actually built, you know, raised beds. And so went from the bottom, you know, had to clear out rocks and you know, get the wood, cut it, stain it, you know, get everything arranged, and then get and build up the soil properly, you know, that,
right?
You know, if you don't have a good base there and the compost and all the things. And then we're in Colorado, so we got pretty extreme temperature variations and things like that. And so all of that preparation, and then the planting, in which, again, planted early inside to be able to transfer things outside once the weather, you know, we have to wait until almost June to be able to take things outside because, you know, we get snow, you know, as early as September and as late as end of May. And so being, you know, it's kind of that process oriented thing. And we've been enjoying tomatoes and zucchini and Swiss chard and, you know, beets and basil and all kinds of things, you know, through for months now. We're right about at the end of that season. But that's been something that I've enjoyed.
We just had our first frost in Michigan, so it's the days are surely coming, certainly.
Yeah, well, early in September, we actually had almost 6 inches of snow here. And so I, you know, built, you know, basically something to protect everything because we still had a lot of fruit on the vine and food. And so I was like, well, I'm going to do what I can. And had a little heat lamp up in the upstairs area where I pulled a couple plants and put them under a heat lamp and put, you know, surrounded things to protect them. But they've been flourishing for another month plus since then.
Good for you. Good for you. Nothing like a homegrown tomato either. That's the best.
Oh, so good. So good.
Well, I want to thank you, Sir Neal, for your time and for your insights and for the conversation. And thank you for being part of Celebrity Interviews with Paul.
Absolutely. It was great to be here. Thanks a lot for the ask.